So this collection of videos or sections is called Google's Best Team Collaboration Tools, and we're going to be talking about communication and collaboration tools from Google, covering some stuff that we haven't covered in a long time, actually. So we're going to cover currents and some other bits and pieces, and I'm looking forward to this. Now, why is this important for you? Well, it's important for you to make sure that your team are collaborating effectively and actually working together. And Google's got all these tools, but I want to try and demystify them a little bit. So we are IT Genius, and we help small business owners get the most out of their tech. And we are all about helping you get technology working well in your business to help you grow and scale and work more effectively. We're all about empowering your teams so that they can collaborate, communicate effectively. And we want you, the business owner, to learn a bit more about technology so that you can actually be the driving force behind technology strategy in your business. And that will mean that for you, you can build a greater business. Because we all know that when we add technology to a business like the Ubers and the menu logs of the world, that we actually have big leaps in how the world works and how businesses work as well. So we've grown and scaled a quite successful business now. And so we've got heaps to teach on how to grow and scale teams, particularly international teams. And that's what we love doing, helping small businesses get ahead. If you haven't already checked out our growth roadmap, head along to our YouTube channel, check on the playlists function, and you'll see we have specific playlists for each level of business. No matter where you are right now, we've got technology strategy, which will help you get ahead in your business. So no matter what stage of business you're at, we've got different ways of helping you out in making sure that you're on fire. So we're going to be talking about Google's best team collaboration tools. The first part of this video is talking about Google Chat versus Groups versus Currents. And I'm going to attempt to demystify the difference between these different applications and where you might choose to use one or the other. Now, Google have created multiple different apps for communicating and collaborating with team members, and they are important now more than ever with everybody working from home. Although Google have a bit of a way of, allowing their users to get a little lost in all the different options that are available for tools. So it's important for you to choose the right tool, because if you're, trying to screw something in with a screwdriver, you don't want to try and use a hammer to knock it in, right? We want to use the right tool for the job. And so it's really important for us to make sure that when we're utilizing Google's tools or any tools in our business, that we actually choose something that is going to be effective. So my aim here is to attempt to demystify the difference between Groups, Chat, and Currents, where you might use either of those, and to give you a bit of an idea of what are the individual features of each of those, because there's been some changes that have happened. And so up to the minute, I'm going to be showing what the current features are on each one of these applications, and where you may choose to use them inside your business. So let's start with Google Groups. And Google Groups basically started out as just something called distribution lists inside of Google. And distribution lists are effectively an email group. They work kind of similar to the kind of way that a contact group would work, whereas you can email one group or one email address, and then it will shoot that out to a number of different people. And Google does some kind of like funky stuff with that. When you email a group, one of these special groups inside of your Google Workspace account, it will collect all of those emails in one place, and that becomes like the distribution list. And then anyone who replies to that thread, the emails basically get sent back to everyone on there. And that's kind of useful. These days, we've kind of moved away from email being a collaboration tool in businesses. And although large organizations still probably use a lot of email for their communication, I'm really anti-email for internal communication within a business, because I think it's just horribly inefficient. And the other problem with email is as soon as you go into your inbox, you get distracted with all the other junk that's in there. And so if you're using email for your internal conversations, you're going to get distracted by emails from people outside the business, and they're probably going to be distracting you as well. So I'm not a fan of using distribution lists for emails, especially internally inside a business. Next up, you have the discussion boards feature, and this acts a little bit more like a forum. Now, again, this is like a kind of older feature, and it works. I don't specifically have any like particular use cases that I talk to about, for small businesses that may use a discussion board, but that feature is there. I don't know what it's useful for. I can't think of anything. So let's move on. Next up, we have the collaborative mailbox. And this is the one that gets really, really useful. And so Google have their own version of a collaborative mailbox. And that is basically one place where emails come to. And that might be help@itgenius.com or hello@itgenius.com. And that one, Mailbox, is basically where multiple people can see into and start managing email from one place. And so a collaborative mailbox is really useful if you've got lots of customers who need service or support or customer service, or for whatever reason you want to consolidate the communication with those customers and have multiple people help out with it. And that would make sense if you've got like a customer service team or a sales team or a support or delivery team of some sort, and they want to all be working with one common email address back and forward between you and your customers. Now, the collaborative inbox that Google has out of the box is okay, and if you're just doing the basics, it'll get the job done, but really it's not as sophisticated as would be useful to a business who's doing a high volume of requests. And by a high volume of requests, I mean more than like 5 emails a day. If you're getting more than 5 emails a day to your collaborative inbox, or you want some more features, you might consider using a third-party tool instead. And so the tool that we recommend is called Hiver, and we're a reseller, so if you're interested in this application, please chat to our team, because we've got discounts and other perks available. Now, what Hiver basically does is a couple of key features. Number one, it lets you have shared labels, and so you don't have to go out of your inbox and into a second tab to open up the collaborative inbox like you have to do with Google's one. Hiver just lives straight in your inbox, and the shared tabs and labels just basically show up there for everyone, which is really groovy. Secondly, it lets you do things like add guaranteed response times. You can put internal notes on tickets and a few other bits and pieces that you just can't do with the Google solution. But thirdly, and this is the most important one, is it's got customer satisfaction built in. And so what that means is that customers can give feedback on how their experience is working with your team, and you get all kinds of reports on what that satisfaction is and how that's been delivered. And what I love about that is that gives you the opportunity to really know, well, what is the performance of my team? How are they actually delivering support, and what's the experience that our customers are getting? Now, many ticketing systems or customer service systems will actually wait until a request is finished or closed before they send a customer service rating. And I don't like that, because sometimes a customer may have an email conversation open and they want to give feedback during the course of the project or during the course of the process of getting support. And with Hiver, what happens is every single email that goes out has those customer service buttons on the bottom. And what that means is that you're always getting rapid feedback, not waiting till the end of a request when the customer's like steaming away if they haven't had a good experience, but when they're actually during the process. So we've got more videos on Hiver. Check out our YouTube channel for that. So that is the collaborative mailbox and kind of like the version of groups that allows you to get stuff done within Google. Now, it's okay for the basics. If you're a small team, 2 or 3 people, and you just need something really basic, it works great. But really, that's just, you know, a matter of sharing emails with people in a basic way. Once you've grown to a business that's flourished, then you want to start looking at a more dedicated ticketing and customer service system, which is going to suit your business a little bit better. Next up, let's talk about chat. And this is something that Google's put a lot of development into over the last few years. Now, you may still have the ghost of Hangouts hanging around, which is challenging. And for many people, they had a bad experience with Google Hangouts, and it was pretty average, to be completely honest. And Google Hangouts was something that lived inside a Chrome kind of like extension that you had to add, and you could chat to people, but it was really one-on-one. And unfortunately, the only thing that really Hangouts was useful for was instant messaging. It didn't do video calls or phone calls great because it was so slow, and so lots of people got frustrated with that and ended up eventually using Skype or Zoom or other solutions. It wasn't until Google rewrote Hangouts completely into Google Meet that they finally started doing meetings well, and it took a long time for people to trust Google again to do video meetings, because Google Hangouts was just so slow and crappy pretty much. But really, Google's now done a great effort in actually building chat into something that is really, really useful for everyone. And let's be honest, they were about 3 years too late to do this, and Slack came in and has created an amazing tool which heaps and heaps of people started using. But bit by bit, we're seeing a lot of customers coming back to using Google Chat because it's free, and it's deeply integrated with the rest of Google Workspace. Now, some of the features of chat are it is living inside of your Gmail. So this is probably one of the best features in that it's right there every time you're doing your work. Next up, you can use rooms or, you know, these would be called channels inside Slack if you're familiar with that. But inside a room, you can actually create threads of conversations and you can see all the emojis and things like that are all included in it there. And so what that does is let you organize the chats into different teams or different groups, which makes it really useful. It's integrated with Meet, which is pretty cool. There's a Meet bot. And what that lets you do is actually automatically have a meeting schedule between different people that you have in a group, and it goes and checks their calendars to see when people are available, all kinds of cool stuff like that. And you can see there's even a little Meet button there. And with that Meet button, you can just click one button and jump straight into a meeting. And so I often find when I'm chatting to a colleague back and forth on chat and we really just need to hash it out over a quick conversation, I just click one button and then all of a sudden we're quickly into a Google Meet with each other, which is really cool. Next up, Google have built in the ability to for third-party developers to create bots. And so there's all kinds of bots available for Google Meet. And so you can see this is a Giphy bot. We've got a poll bot there where you can create little polls and things like that. Basically, it's going to automatically, I can see there that someone's used the phrase test and it's brought up scones. don't know why it's done that. But basically, it allows you to, communicate outside of just your chat, which is pretty damn groovy. The basics of messaging each other are still there, but what Google have brought is their AI and machine learning technology into Google Chat. And so you can see here when sending a message, you actually have the smart replies that pop up, just like in Gmail, and it makes things super easy. So they are some pretty compelling features of chat, but there is one big downside. And the big downside of chat is that you have an interruption factory. And instant messaging is a big challenge. What that means is that because we have the ability to be always on with everyone, it means that everyone can interrupt us all day long. And you've heard all the studies that it takes 45 minutes to get back into your deep work. And I don't think deep work actually exists anymore in a modern organization because we're just literally being pinged all day long. And so I like the idea of moving out of chat for tasks, not using chat for tasks and not using email for tasks, but we kind of need somewhere else to go that isn't inside our, you know, instant messaging and communication platform. And we've talked extensively about other task tools. I'm going to cover tasks a little bit later on in this presentation series, so check out the upcoming section on that. But the challenges that we have is when we're using instant messaging for chat all the time, it means that we're constantly interrupting our colleagues, and that may mean that we're less productive overall. So we've got to be really careful with that. Let's talk about Google Currents, and this is Google's third tool for us to communicate and keep in touch with our team. Now, Google Currents is pretty much just a new skin slapped onto Google Plus. Now, I don't know if it was just because of the privacy issue and security issue that happened with Google Plus a little while ago, but Google decided to give it a rebrand and give it a relaunch. But really, it's, I don't know if it's like a wolf in sheep's clothing, if that's the right analogy for it, but it's maybe just kind of like more of the same stuff. Now, think of it a little bit like what you would use Google Workspace for, or Google Workplace, sorry. And that is a place where your team can collaborate, share things. I'd say there's less collaboration there. It's more just a matter of actually posting things and sharing them with your team. It's great in a larger organization. So if you've got more than 30 or 40 employees, it makes sense that you might want to share updates in a social way. Personally, I've found it's not super useful in our organization at the size that we're at. And the thing with that is because I find that what people use Currents for is a very socially acceptable way of communicating. It's like the professional version of Facebook. And here's my little status update, and it's worded nicely, and it has a nice picture, and I've got a nice photo, and everyone really wants to, you know, look nice and look good with it. And that's just not the kind of business that we run at IT Genius. We're pretty loose. We've got a really strong culture of having fun with each other and being more social than, let's say, how a usual hashtag professional environment would actually operate. And so I find that using Currents is not that useful for us. Also, it might just be a matter of our team size. Like we've got, I think, about 45 people in the company now, and most people have a personal relationship with each other. And so we haven't kind of reached the stage where we have staff who absolutely don't know each other at all. And I think in a larger organization, that makes a lot more sense. So that's why we don't use currents, but that's not necessarily why you shouldn't use currents. Currents is definitely useful. What we find ourselves using more of is our chat. And so we've got a water cooler chat inside our Google chat in a room called water cooler. And then we've got our main team chat, and we use that to post GIFs. We use that to react to things. We use that for our kind of daily chit chat. And so we've got an overview of a number of different tools here. We've got our groups, which are really, you know, kind of like an outdated way of doing things in email, but can be used for a collaborative inbox, which are useful. We've got chat, which is like our instant messaging and our way of staying in rapid communication with each other, but it has the downside of interrupting. And then thirdly, we've got Google Currents, which may be a useful tool for larger teams, and it's great for broadcasting messages in a non-interrupting way. But the downside of Currents then is that there's another tab that you've got to check. There's just like one more thing to go to. And I asked my marketing manager, Angel, before we set up this live stream, why don't we use Currents internally? And she said, because it's boring AF. And I've got to say, I've got a little bit of that vibe about it as well. It's not the most fun or engaging platform to use, at least on Facebook. When I've got the sound switched on my mobile, there's you know, little like notifications and things like that, which are going to pump some dopamine for me when I'm using the application. And I just can't say that about Currents right now, that it's a pleasure to use. So I want to give it a go. I'm just yet to find that use case for it myself. We're going to talk in an upcoming section on this series on how to use Google Tasks and all the different features that you've got of Tasks. And we'll talk a little bit about how Tasks compares to a tool like Asana, which is a third-party shared task management tool. So let me know your thoughts on that below. Drop some comments down and let me know what you guys think.